Okay, just hold that steady while I fasten the cover, and this bird is ready to fly.
Oof, it's very heavy. Good thing I'm healing.
Did I ever tell you about the time I nearly died over the bear at sea?
Yeah, it's now the time.
Just bear with me. So there we were. Long-haul cargo run to Murmansk, flying through an Arctic storm.
Getting to point, please.
Suddenly, the right engine loses thrust. Then the left. They're cycling, but there's no power. We're losing altitude, dipping the nose to keep ourselves out of a storm. The Arctic Ocean's starting to get real big in that windshield, and we're trying everything to get those engines firing.
Yes, I'm with you. Very good.
That's when I realized it was so cold, there was ice forming on the fuel filters, blocking the flow. The engines were starving.
And so you fix and save the day, all done.
That's when I remembered the APU.
Anyone? Yes? Shoulders?
That's right, the auxiliary power unit. I fired her up and let her overheat. Could have blown up at any second, but it was warm in the fuel. Melted ice. We're down to 500 feet when suddenly, wham, the engines come back to life. I can smell the APU cooking from the cockpit, but we made it back in one piece. Okay, you can let go.
I'm glad you survived, Chief, but what is point?
The point is, a jet like this is a machine full of machines. Scatter redundancies built in. Cross feeds, backups, manual reversion, you name it. There's always something you can use to get the job done. Now, we want to jump the carrier back to 2040, but we need more power. I have an idea.
Oh, Chief, what's all this?
This is our way to Leviathan. We want to go to 2040. Not enough power. We want to help my sister make her Lozar plan work. Not enough power. As much as I hate to admit he's right, it's like science said. We needed that revolution cylinder. But Durban stole the data, and we couldn't fabricate one here anyway. Which meant we were out of luck. Unless we use a substitute.
The transmission cable linked to the carrier's generator drive shaft.
Right. The problem with this little vortexer is not enough torque. It can't spin fast enough to generate the kind of vortex we need.
So Chief linked it up to military-grade jet engine shaft.
I always knew this bird would get us off the island. What I didn't know was I'd have to turn her into a time machine to do it. Sandy's working on the calculations now.
Sandy? Is this really going to get us back to 2040?
Based on the firmware update we received from Dr. Garrett Sines, we have ample power to travel back to 2040 and confront Leviathan.
And hopefully not back to Middle Ages like Bigatoa.
You mean you don't want to be a goddess during the Inquisition?
You tell joke, but where's Liv?
I have records of the vortexes that transport Ace to the war game in 2040. We can follow Leviathan's example.
Not comforting.
And as for destabilizing Heizo, we did a little test. Look at this.
Baboom. Lozol. Running this thing in reverse really works.
We're going to take off, jump the carrier back to 2040, fly to the Leviathan's core platform, and turn Leviathan's fuel tanks into a ticking time bomb.
There's just the matter of Durban. Who knows we're coming, by the way.
But Ace will be ready to take care of that.
Chief, all this sounds ridiculously dangerous. Not that I'm backing out or anything, but...
Let me finish up here. Then we'll talk.
There it is. We now know more about this island than anyone else on Earth.
In multiple timeline color code.
Yeah, that's pretty simple when you have all the pieces. Well, simple is a relative term, of course. Look, this is what started it all. The Origin Suit's pilot, Yannick Nadi, tries to go back in time and prevent his future by destroying Leviathan, but ends up hurled back to the Cretaceous period. So that's the first change in the timeline. Nadi dies, and his exosuit stays buried for millions of years. Ibeus finds the exosuit and the futuristic technology. It blows their minds. They reverse engineer it, and they realize they've got their hands on an energy revolution.
Heisel. And because they are greedy, unscrupulous bastards, they build a world full of Stratovators, all Golden Goose equipped, to drill into the past and break down space-time, overseen by an unprecedented AI developed from Origin Suit Tech, which was exactly the world Nadi wanted to prevent.
Which cues up Future Past You. Future Past You goes back to prevent Ibeus from getting Golden Goose, and thus, the second alteration of the island's history occurs, and the timeline changes again. The entire Bicatoan culture comes from Future You going too far back in time and being mistaken for a goddess. Then, we have a lull in the time travel antics with not much happening until 2020, but 2020 hits, and wham! Ibeus finds the Origin Suit, and the entire cycle begins again.
And so we come to August 16th, 2040. Ibeus gives Leviathan full control of the Stratovator's Golden Goose Array, with nobody realizing it is obsessed with developing exosuits. Next thing we know, dinosaurs are raining from the sky all over Island. Leviathan makes itself perfect exosuit testing ground.
Right. So, Haruka tries to destroy Leviathan, but she can't, because she can't create enough Lozol to do the job. She's got Yannick Nadi on her side, or some echo of him that's still bouncing around the Ibeus systems, but somehow Leviathan catches on to what they're doing.
Surprise, surprise, machine programmed by amoral maniacs is amoral maniac.
Leviathan purges all the Lozol off the Stratovator control platform, which explodes and sends the cable crashing down on the island.
A Bicator incident.
Dr. Garrett Sines escapes alive, but Golden Goose is lost in the wreckage. Ibeus stands to lose their Heisal energy revolution.
And in the meantime, Leviathan still running war games on the island, repeating the Bicator incident day after day, time after time. All while space-time distortions and dinosaurs become a damn pandemic and innocent people all over the world pay the price.
Ibeus creates problem, then sells world the solution. They form exo-fighter squads, and we crash on the island, and Leviathan gets aced as a new plaything for the war game. Magnum, Durbin, Dr. Sines, and God knows how many others all arrive on the same way in their own separate timelines.
Now, Magnum thought he'd found a way out when he got part of Golden Goose, but that only made him a target for Durbin. And we were next. Little did we know, we were up against the most deadly foe of all. Me, with two arms.
You forgot part about them being disgusting grave robbers, using corpse to do dirty work.
Zombies.
Anchor Division, Haruka, Golden Goose, and zombies. All of it, it's all there.
What I don't understand, what's this thing's motive? Huh? How does an AI become obsessed? Dinosaurs, self-preservation. There's no way for a computer to behave.
Well, I think we've all seen just how little it takes for a really good AI to develop into something more.
Compliment acknowledged.
Oh, so much history, all of it leading to us, right here, right now.
I mean, you could almost call it fate. And look at us. Haruka's brother, Durbin's doppelganger, the goddess of Bicatoa herself, and Ace, the best exo fighter in the fleet.
Second best.
Yes, right. Sorry, Madge. But the point is, out of thousands of exo fighter crews out there, it's come down to us.
But the chart is missing one thing.
What's that, Chief?
We're about to be the most important thing that ever happened on this island. Sandy.
Understood.
Perfect.